I was waiting for more. I was getting into that bit of music then. Thank you. That was a good one. Thank you so much, Shane, putting together all of our videos and bits and pieces. Right. We are a small and intimate gathering now, are we not, Nick? Yes? I've been asked by a couple of you what happened to the sports analogies that we were using yesterday. Indeed. So we shall continue though. As people walk up, I'd like you to look at said presenters and imagine them on the sporting field and imagine what they might be doing on that sporting field and what position they might play. And we'll see if you're right at the end. We will, of course, also take keen interest in what it is that they have to say and the prospect that they are offering up to us. But that will be our fun thing on the side. All right, first up, let's get into this. And also, just while we're in here, I'm not going to go out there and ring the bell again, because do you remember that we are drawing the prize for the $500 crown voucher straight after this presentation? And if they're not in the room, they miss out. So I've asked them actually to bring me a stack of in this order like this. Now, why are you looking so happy just there? You are. Paul, hello.
Yes, you did.
You know, you look down, you think someone's not looking as happy. What are you looking at? What is
program of 8 sessions this afternoon, looking forward to them all, especially number 8.
What's number 8? Is that the end with drinks?
That's the end.
It's the end with drinks. That's not right, Paul. Okay, good on you, mate. All right, we'll see what we can get for you. I like it. That's my signal to get my act together and get on. Right, so our first individual to come up here on the stage, actually interesting bit of trivia about this fellow. He's doing his bit for women in STEM. His daughter is studying engineering. He's the only engineer in his family at the moment doing STEM, but his daughter's doing STEM. He's got his nieces enrolled in engineering. So he's doing his bit for a bit of sexual diversity in the industry. I had been trying, and I'm speaking nonsense to you, because I tried to get out of him what it is, because you know that I like to go around and I like to chat to our presenters beforehand so I can get an essence, and some of you I haven't got to yet, an essence of what the actual talk is about so I can give you the headline. This fellow, I've been chasing him for basically the last 24 hours because, no, I can't tell you. No, it's a secret. No, I can't give anything away. So this is Martin Wilkes, who keeps secrets obviously very, very well. He is the Managing Director at RISC, which of course is an independent international energy advisory company. They're headquartered here in Perth, Western Australia. I think we all know that one. What's the actual title? The title is Not All Resources Are Equal. Again, I did try to get out of it, well, what it was that he was going to be talking about. But he talked about, do you know what? And then I thought, simply, it's harder to get anything out of this man than a browse gap development. So I'll leave it at that and let's see what he has to say. Please make him welcome, everyone.
Thanks, Chrissy. Thanks to the event organisers for having me back again. I never know whether they're going to invite me back because I try and be a little bit controversial, and hopefully the same today. 5 years ago, if you were here, and I hope most of you were, you might remember that I described exploration like playing cricket. I'm not a cricket player anymore, by the way, and I told Chrissy about another sport I used to play. So if you're going to guess the game, it's not cricket, okay? I'm not going to put you through that analogy again this year. I'm going to talk about resources and reserves. And the title was Not All Resources Are Equal. And I thought instead I'd subject you to a really bad quote or misquote from one of my favorite authors, George Orwell, Animal Farm. All resources are equal, but some resources are more equal than others. And of course, the issue is that they're not actually equal. And you've been hearing a lot about 2P, 2C, reserves, resources throughout the day. You might think that that means they're all talking about the same stuff. And technically, they probably should be, but actually they're not. And I'm going to use just a few examples to explain to you why they're not. Hopefully, we'll get there. Just first, who we are, if you don't know about RISC. We're not a company that owns oil and gas assets. We don't produce anything. I'm not here asking any investors for money, which begs the question, why am I here? Well, our job here is actually to connect with all our clients. So most of the other presenters you've been listening to are our clients. And if they're not, I want them to be our clients. What's in it for you as investors from having us involved in the industry? Well, we provide an independent second opinion, if you like. We're not exactly policemen of the industry, but sometimes we perform a role that's a bit similar. I like to think that we tell people what they need to hear, not what they want to hear. So everyone has a disclaimer. The difference is this one you should actually be able to read. And I won't go through it, but while you're reading it, I'll just talk to you a little bit about what we are going to say and what I'm going to talk about. Not all resources are equal. 50 BCS of gas is 50 BCF of gas, isn't it? You know, wherever it might be. Well, yes and no, it is volumetrically the same gas. But if you find 50 BCF of gas in the Perth Basin, which a lot of people have found a lot more than that, you've probably got a pretty good project. If you find that same 50 BCF of gas, let's say 300 kilometers offshore in 1500 meters of water with nothing around it, you probably haven't. And that's one of the differences we see. I'm going to talk you through some of the other differences we see in resource and reserves estimates as well. So the only thing I'd point out on this slide is that, of course, we look at things. Our internal motto is tell people what they need to hear, not what they want to hear. That means we sometimes disagree with our clients. So we sometimes disagree with the views of some of the people in the room. I think that's a good thing, and they don't always have to agree with us like we don't always agree with them. So we provide a different perspective, a second perspective. I like to think we're pretty good at what we do, and most of the time we get things right. Now, in order to preserve our client basis and not to upset anybody, none of the examples I'm going to use today involve any of the companies that are here presenting today. And I'm not saying that any of them would end up with any of these results, but I just want to make everyone aware that not all resources and not all reports are equivalent. So, I can't talk about resources without actually talking about the structure within which we work, which is the aptly named Petroleum Resources Management System, or PRMS as is known in the industry. This is sort of what it looks like, and you've heard about 2U, 2P, 2C. These things have been talked about today. And this is basically what it is. Prospective resources haven't been found yet. Contingent resources have been found, but they're not developed yet. They might be developed at some point in the future, or they might not be. And reserves, yes, we're going ahead and we're going to get these out of the ground. And of course, at the top, things that's already been produced. So there's a categorization of these things, a subcategorization as well in terms of where they stand in things. And basically, the aim of the oil and gas companies is to move things through from a basin entry, looking at a play through a lead prospect, into something they've discovered, a contingent resource, and then eventually turning that into a project and getting reserves. Now, that should give us a fairly good structure to work with, and I think it does. But there are a couple of problem areas with it, and hopefully the examples I'm about to show you will highlight those. So the first one is this bit here, contingent resources, development pending, and reserves justified for development. At what point does something turn from a contingent resource into a reserve? When is it just, yes, we still think we're going to develop it, to, yes, we are going to develop it, but we haven't actually quite approved it yet. And that's a bit of a gray area in the industry, which I'll highlight. And the other bit that I am not completely comfortable with is this increasing chance of commerciality. I think that this should actually start about here. Because whilst you're talking about undiscovered resources, there might be nothing there. And therefore, there isn't any increasing chance of commerciality. There's just an increasing chance that you might drill something to maybe find something. If you find it and it's not viable at all, is it really a resource? Because a resource by nature is something that you are going to use or can use. So these are some of the things that we'll try and cover off on in one way or another. So first example, this is with reference to the Browse Gas Development. Two quite large companies that we work with, Woodside and Santos, and two developments, Browse and Barossa. arguably back in 2019, 2020 timeframe, they were both in the same position. Browse, billed as Australia's largest conventional gas resource yet to be developed, about 14 TCF, discovered in the 1970s. 50 years it's been a contingent resource. It's quite a long time, nearly as old as me. It's approached FID twice. I was involved in one of those, if I remember rightly. James Price Point, if you remember, they even started earth moving, pulled back, didn't happen. Then they went to FLNG. I'm actually a bit of a fan of FLNG, but it was going to be Prelude lookalikes, and Prelude's had its problems, as we know. They pulled back from that as well. It's now targeted as backfiltered north of Shell Venture. So hopefully, third time lucky, they'll get a project up and running, and they will be able to turn their 2C into 2P, contingent resources into reserves. Now, I actually think they've done the right thing here, because at no point in that, you know, we've nearly got there, oh no, we haven't, did they say, now we have reserves because we're about to do it, so it's justified for development, we're going to go ahead and do it. Not even when they were earth moving at James Price Point. So, tick for that in my book. I think they've done the right thing. Barossa, discovered a lot later. It's a mere baby by comparison. And in fact, that's younger than my oldest daughter. FID'd in March 2020, and of course, Santos were able to say, right, we'll turn our contingent resources into reserves. Successfully done so. Now, again, tick. Right thing to do. The highlight here, of course, is at what point do you make that decision? At what point do contingent resources become reserves? And as we know, with Barossa, they thought they had all their approvals, and now it seems like they're going to have some legal challenges to get through as well, which weren't part of the story when they made that decision. I still think they're in the right place with having reserves, and it will go ahead, but two different stories. Sorry, I didn't mention. This is the Browse development picture here. Browse fields up here, talking about a 900 or so kilometer pipeline back to the Northwest Shelf. And then Barossa, equivalent, it's backfilled to the Darwin facility there. So those are the two maps. Easy, that's all fairly straightforward, and you probably all know that, and why have I spent so much time on it? Next one is about a company that isn't represented here. And this is all on the public domain. So Lee Creek Energy in 2019, you might remember, came out with the statement, we've got the biggest 2P reserves, uncontracted 2P reserves on the East Coast. Raised a few eyebrows, I'm sure it did within the industry as a whole. And for us, we thought, well, let's have a look at that. So they did a comparison. They said, well, we've got just over a TCF of gas here compared to all these other companies. There are a few things that I have concerns with about that. One, the project was basically at the demonstration stage. They'd just done a commercial pilot demonstration plant, which they'd shut down. They still had feasibility to get through, and a FEED project was earmarked to start a few months later. They were looking for funding for FEED, so they weren't even looking for funding for the project at that stage. They were looking for funding to do further study. And they had a project plan shown down here, which said, we think we might get to an FID decision, i.e. we might get to a project in 3 years' time. Now, my book, that's not reserves, that's contingent resources, because they got no approvals, no funding, no project, and not really even much of a development plan in that time. So what's happened since then? Well, the project and company have changed. They're no longer looking to put gas into the grid, which was the original project development scope. And by the way, what they didn't tell people back at the time was that they were producing something called syngas. It's underground coal gasification. It's not conventional or unconventional natural gas. So syngas is different. Actually, in terms of heating value, it's about a quarter of what natural gas is. So it's not compatible with the national gas, any gas system, actually. So they changed their plans to now look at targeting ammonia and urea. On the website now, the current status is preparation for the EIS, which puts them about here. So they're still in that FEED feasibility stage that they were saying they were going to be in a couple of years ago. And I know that they're looking for funding. So they may well have a project to look forward to, but in my book, that's probably still contingent upon a number of things. So I don't think they have reserves. I think they have contingent resources. And I think it's right for an organization like us to question people's views on whether they should have reserves or contingent resources. Now, I said I wasn't going to talk about anyone who was presenting here. Wasn't actually quite true, because this one, I have had permission from Carnarvon Energy to potentially open up an old wound and also potentially lay ourselves open to criticism, because arguably this is a project where RISC got it wrong. So we're not infallible. You know, we're actually a bunch of humans as well behind that sort of corporate glamour of we're advisors to the industry and we do all that. No, we're human as well, and we don't always get it right. I reckon our track record's pretty good. And so I had to go back 3 or 4 years to look at this one. No, 3 years. End of 2020, we did the work. In March 21, we gave Carnarvon and the project contingent resources of the Buffalo Field redevelopment. That was a bit unusual field. BHP had developed it in the 1990s. Closed it off in 2005 because it's right, we developed it all done. Abandoned it, everything taken away, facilities gone. And Carnarvon picked it up in 2016, did some reprocessing work, produced some new maps. It looked great. Our guys went in, they said, yeah, your maps look good. Process looks reasonable. On that basis, it does look like the original development missed something, and there's attic oil there. So we gave them some contingent resources. Of course, the Buffalo 10 well came along and got drilled. I'm about to finish, it's all right. And the drill bit is the great truth teller of all these things. And they didn't have any resources. Hindsight's a wonderful thing. Maybe we should have given them no 1C resources. Last but not least, and I do have to say this one, Greenvale, 600,000 PJs of geothermal energy in the Millerunga Basin in Queensland. Do you know how much that is? Australia uses about 680 petajoules of energy to power its whole electricity generation system for a year. So if that's true, they could supply the whole of the Australian energy requirements for about 700 years. We can all go home. No need for our industry or even any other renewable energy industry or anything. Sorry, when you look at their project though, what they're doing is developing 1 terajoule a day. Now there isn't a geothermal resources management system in place. Maybe there should be. Sorry, Chrissy. Thank you for your time, everybody.
Hockey.
So does Chrissy, by the way.
He's a hockey player and I'm a hockey player, so I gave him a little bit extra. There you go. All right. Our next presenter. Actually, before we get to our next presenter, I've got this fellow here. He's been up near the coffee machine working hard. You might have thought it was Tyson and the crew, but actually it was this guy here, Bushy. So who's put their little card outside? Hand up if you put your card. Hand up. I'm putting mine up, buggy. There was spare spaces. If some of you aren't going to take it, then I'm going to move in and take it. The rules of engagement are you need to be in the room. So, Bushy, do you have a stack in order, or did you?
I have a winner. Thank you.
You did?
Before I get to that, just want to acknowledge Vertical Events for another great event. Stewie and Jackson and Charm and Andrea and their new addition, Di. So, wonderful work. I think you all agree. Chrissy, another great job with your organisation. And just also reconfirm Gallagher's commitment to the energy sector. It's really important for everybody. So we have a long-term commitment and we're very proud to be involved as a partner and a sponsor. And I'm sure you've all enjoyed the coffees over the last couple of days. The draw has taken place. Jackson was present, just so you don't think anything untowards happened. So I'm very pleased to announce that Richard Beament from Horizon Oil is our winner. Now, Richard, I don't have the prize here, so you meet us down at the stand. Be very happy to hand that over.
He's already got a great big fat deposit. He's got lots of stuff there. He doesn't need that. Do you actually need that, Richard? Think about how well you've been going this year. Think of the kiddies.
He's got some valuable staff. I'm sure he's keen to keep happy.
Thank you. Put your hands together for Gallagher, everyone. Thank you so much, guys. I'm going to feel good for him, but I'm feeling a bit cross as well. There we go. Maybe one of us would have liked it. It's a $500 voucher. He could take one of us with us for food or dinner. That would be good. All right, our next presenter. Our next presenter has a very interesting link to Good Oil. So it started back in... Who was here for the first Good Oil? You were? It was an interesting day, wasn't it? 9/11. So I was actually celebrating my eldest son's first birthday that day. So it was an interesting start to an oil and gas conference. And our sponsor on that day was...
Troy Okoda,
and this fellow here was actually in his capacity as their in charge person. They were the sponsor. So they were the sponsor of the very first Good Oil. So he's back today in a very different capacity. He's MD of Prominence Energy to tell us all about Prominence's newest gas exploration project, which is the Big Apple. What are you three laughing for? You can come and sit down the front in a minute if you're being dodgy. He has a lot to say. Right, so we're talking about the Big Apple project and it's located in New Mexico. Pay attention, 15 minutes. Please make him welcome.
Thank you very much. So I'm here to talk about Prominence Energy. We're a small company with large prospects and I'm the quarterback. So that's our usual disclaimer. I'll let you read it later, it's on the release. So a little bit about who we are and what we do. Prominence is an ASX-listed company, code is PRM, and our headquarters are in Perth. Our focus is keeping costs very low and our leverage to success exceedingly high. What we believe is that investors like companies that have tremendous leverage to success. So what we seek to do is find very high return on investment sector, energy sector opportunities that we can secure at as close to ground floor valuations as possible. We're focused primarily on conventional oil and gas, but we also look at things like carbon sequestration, hydrogen, helium, and the likes. Our current focus is on the new project that we just picked up in the Gulf of Mexico, the Big Apple prospect. It's a very large gas prospect with what we think is a very good chance of success. Just to show you that we don't just do conventional oil and gas, we have a 10.9% interest in eco storage solutions, which has an early mover advantage seeking to establish salt caverns in various parts of Australia that may be used for gas storage, hydrogen storage, or for long-term carbon capture and utilization. We're constantly reviewing new venture opportunities and we look at a lot of them. It's very hard to find ones that fit within our investment strategy criteria, but we have found a few over the time. So the key highlights at the moment, the big thing, it's taken a year to get us there. It was a little over a year ago we first identified this opportunity to pick up in a bid round, is the Big Apple prospect. It's in the Gulf, located in the Gulf of Mexico, over two blocks, and we were just granted it in July of this year with a five-year term. This is the sort of thing that perfectly aligns with our investment strategy. It's cost us less than $1 million to pick up, and with greater than a TCF of potential, it's worth many hundreds of times what we are as a company. Our plan is to continue to work it up, seek a farm-out partner, and to help us fund the exploration well, and we should be ready to launch that process early in 2024. We have some other assets, which I won't focus on particularly today. We have a small oil field development pending in the Gulf of Mexico, which does have some reserves, but is subject to drilling of a development well and tieback to a nearby production facility. We have a legacy asset in WA-519P, which is where we drilled the Sassanoff well last year. The well was drilled on time and on budget, but unfortunately it didn't find any gas. And then the eco storage solution. As I said, we are at ground floor valuation at the moment, post the unfortunate result at Sasanoff, but now we're reset with a new opportunity in Big Apple. We did a 20-for-1 consolidation in the middle of this year, and that reduced our share number down to 121 million shares on issue. Our share price is about 2 cents. We just raised some capital, announced that that we've placed 32.5 million shares at 2 cents. So we've got a market cap of about $3 million and cash in the bank of about $1 million. I'm a petroleum engineer with 25 years in the industry. My first 10 years was a consultant at Troy Okoda, very similar to RISC. I know RISC will say that I'm far superior, but what that meant was that I could look at hundreds of projects on a worldwide basis. After that, I moved into executive management roles, CEO of Otto, CEO of Mosaic, 2IC at Q. I was a managing director at Temasker and TMK Montney, and a commercial advisor at Transurf. All told, that means that I've looked at all sorts of projects all over the world, particularly Australia, Asia, and the US. Ian is our chairman. He's got 30 years of experience. He's a finance background, and he's had a lot of experience with small resource companies, including Eureka Energy and other resource companies. Troy is our third director, makes up pretty much the rest of the team. He has 27 years of oil and gas, including 12 years with Woodside. Notably, he spent 2.5 years based in Louisiana as vice president of Woodside's Gulf of Mexico, in charge of Woodside's Gulf of Mexico portfolio, and he's also got small company experience with TAP and Global. Sonu is our CFO and company secretary. So I'll talk a bit about our portfolio, but primarily about the Big Apple prospect. This is a summary. I won't read this one out, but you can look at it later. So Big Apple, where is it and how did it come about? It's located 200 kilometers south of Houston, about 90 kilometers offshore, in the Brazos South Edition area. It's on the shelf, it's in about 75 meters of water, so it can be drilled with a jackup. What's great about the US is you can pick things up by leasing the acreage. You don't have any firm well commitments, you don't have any ongoing work program that you must undertake. So the holding cost for this is around $57,000 per block each year. If we don't like what we see, we can drop it and there's no more costs, there's no obligations, but we believe that this is quite a good prospect and we're gonna be looking for a partner to participate in the drilling. So where are we? In board of us, there's plenty of historical gas fields. The Gulf of Mexico, as I'm sure you're aware, is a very prolific area. There are gas fields inboard of us, and there are deep water gas and oil fields outboard of us. Quite notably, Exxon has just picked up a vast swathe of acreage across these historical fields, which have been off production for a number of years, presumably with a view to doing carbon sequestration into them. We're in a great location. There's infrastructure around us, and because it's the Gulf of Mexico, rig availability, service companies, equipment is all free, is all quick to get together. Notably, we're just south of Freeport, which is where the LNG where one of the LNG plants are. So there's a map of the infrastructure. Big Apple is here. The closest pipeline with ullage in it is only 15 miles away. That connects us into the major gas network that can feed any one of these LNG liquefaction facilities, but particularly Freeport, Corpus Christi, and Sabine Pass. The rise of LNG in the US has been nothing short of meteoric. 10 years ago, they didn't produce, they didn't export any LNG. The US is a giant gas market. It consumes over 100 BCF of gas a day, and the US, by the end of this year, is set to be the world's largest LNG exporter by country. LNG exports have averaged around 11.6 BCF a day in the first half of 2023, and are set to rise to 20 BCF of gas at the end of 2027. The gas demand is rising rapidly. Gas production in the last decade has come largely from the shale plays in the US, but a lot of those have stabilized off. Even the Marcellus, which is the biggest, Production has been pretty flat at about 25 BCF. A lot of these plays are quite dependent on debt, and so as the interest rates have gone up, the drilling rate has slowed, and rig utilization in these plays has dropped by a third from what it was a couple of years ago. We're located just south of the Freeport LNG facility in due east of Corpus Christi, and at over a TCF prospective resources, Big Apple would be material to these LNG projects. So a little bit about where it came from. So a geologist or geophysicist who is in the audience today, he was once upon a time working for one of the major oil and gas companies, working the deep water area where the Diana field is. That company had a seismic line that was upshot up onto the shelf to tie into the known geology up on the shelf. And he saw this rather attractive looking amplitude, which was quite comparable to the Diana field. These are on the same scale. Diana is a large deep water gas and oil prospect. I think it's over a couple of TCF of recoverable gas. So he took it to his employer at the time, and they said, "I'm sure it's very nice, but we only do the deep water." A few years later, he was working for another major in the Gulf of Mexico, and he took it to them, and they said, "I'm sure it's very nice, but it's we only do the deep water." So when he came back to Perth, he still had it in his bottom drawer in the back of his mind, and came to approach my former chairman, Yap, and he told us about it. And we did a bit of work and looked at it, and we bought some seismic and we did some AVO work, and we agreed with him that it looked pretty good. So we've given him a 1% royalty if it's success, and moving forward. So we pre-qualified for a bid round, and we bid on this block, and we picked it up, and it was awarded in July of this year. The Big Apple prospect sits in 75 meters of water. It's at a depth of about 2,600, 2,700 meters. It can be drilled from a jackup. The drilling cost on a dry hole cost basis would be less than $15 million. So we think this is doable and very attractive. The AVO work, so AVO is what you do to get the best out of your seismic. And if you've got a gas-filled sand, it has better contrast than a water-filled sand. And so you look for an AVO anomaly. And a class 3 AVO anomaly is a good indication that it's probably a gas-filled sand. In the middle of our main sand, we've got a very strong class 3 AVO anomaly. Deeper down is a class 4, which is probably residual gas, or if we're incredibly lucky, an oil leg. And the AVO work identified a secondary sand, which was less obvious on the raw seismic, that could be 10 or 15 meters thick. Overall, it's quite a promising looking prospect. We bought all the seismic, we've mapped it up. We've got three blocks across the structure and the two sands. We gave this to Netherland, Sewell, the US equivalent of RISC. They checked our numbers, they did a probabilistic estimate, and they were looking at a total 2U, so that's undiscovered, most likely case, of about 1.7 TCF of gas. Now, our net revenue interest after royalties payable to the government, to that geoscientist, if he's as lucky as he will be 80.25%. So our net prospective resources is about 1.37 TCF of gas, right next to the world's biggest gas market. To put that in context, if we make that discovery, and it'll either be there or it won't be there, but if it is, you can sell gas, undeveloped gas in the US in this sort of area for at least 25 cents an MCF in the ground. So that would be worth, assuming we kept a third of this for a free carry through the well, that would be worth $200 million or about 100 times what our current market cap is. So just in summary, we've got our Big Apple gas opportunity. We're working that up ahead of the plan to farm it out next year. In the Gulf of Mexico, planning, permitting times, rig availability is such that we should be able to drill about 6 months after we secured that partner. We're working up trying to find a partner to help share in the development of the bowsprit, which is which could yield good cash flow to fund higher higher impact opportunities. And hopefully eco storage solution will be going to IPO later sometime in the next 12 months. We're constantly reviewing new venture activities. And the problem is you can't talk about them until they're crystallized, but there are things in progress. So with that, I'll say thank you very much. I'll be around at the conference for the rest of the day. If you've got any questions, I'll be delighted to talk to you. Thank you.
So two questions. What sport does he play? Because I actually have no idea. What do you reckon? Pardon? What do the naughty boys think? Bowls, did you say? Yeah, you're right. Okay, what would you really play?
Oh, I love American football. I've been going to the US for so long, I've now picked up a big love of American football, and I'm a New Orleans Saints supporter.
Ah, okay.
How old? The quarterback reference.
That's right. How old are you, actually?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm nearly 50.
Okay, all right, that's okay. I was just wondering, because I think you were a real baby-faced boy to be in charge of Troy Okoda all the way back then. What were they thinking?
Very good.
You need a smart comeback there.
Kris Lewis, who's here, I took over from Kris. He was the managing director at the time. He was young when he was doing it. It takes a lot of energy to do what RISC does, and Troy Okoda. Finding and keeping clients happy is a young man's game.
But you know, you get the patience for finding these big resources or reserves, which I'm getting it wrong, aren't I? Resources or reserves.
Prospective resources.
Hopefully to be reserved by the end of next year. Phantasmagoric. Thank you so much. Would you put your hands together, please, for Alexander? Invictus Energy, come up and join us, sir. Led by our serious Zimbabwean, who we claimed as our own, came over here to Perth 20 years ago to study, and we got him on board. He hasn't left since. This is Scott Macmillan. He's the CEO of Invictus, and his team is on the verge of spudding an appraisal exploration well known as Mukuyu-2, which is in the Kabora Basin in North Zimbabwe. It's one of the largest untested frontier basins on the African continent, and it follows a successful play opening campaign, and it was completed back with January, wasn't it?
That's
he was very excited when he was telling me this before, because I said, how big is it?
It's enormous.
Enormous. I asked, I was thinking he'll give me some sort of a square kilometer, and he said enormous, and his eyes lit up. So let's listen to what he has to say and see if it's something you'd like in your investment portfolio.
Thank you, Chrissy. And as you alluded to earlier, it is enormous. We're on the proverbial elephant hunt, and elephants in oil and gas parlance are fields that have greater than 1 billion barrels of potential. And so we're out taking a big swing here. In Zimbabwe, lions have successfully learned how to hunt elephants, and we're on the verge of taking down a big elephant that we call Mukuyu. So we're building on our basin opening well that we completed late last year, early this year, called Mukuyu-1, where we, the very first well in the basin, wildcat drilling, it doesn't get much more frontier than where we were. We encountered multiple light oil, gas, and helium-bearing reservoirs. Mukuyu-2, which is our follow-up well, will be spudding within the next couple of weeks. So a very exciting time at the company. We've got an action-packed couple of months ahead of us. We have also now extended our acreage area, and we've just acquired some additional 2D following the play with Mukuyu, as well as a new basin margin play that we've developed. I'll talk about in a little while. We've got a dominant acreage position in the Kabora Basa Basin in Zimbabwe, where we are, and we hold the rights to the prospective play fairway. And we've got multiple play types within our acreage area and an enormous portfolio of prospects and leads, which total over 5.5 billion barrels of oil equivalent, and hopefully some more to come now with that additional seismic data and maturing some additional drill-ready candidates. Invictus as a snapshot, we've got three licenses in Zimbabwe, Special Grant 4571 and EPOs 1848 and 1849. That is a 360,000 hectare position, just over 3,500 square kilometers. We've got multiple play types and drill-ready prospects. Makuyu, which is the biggest one out of that portfolio, is 20 TCF and 845 million barrels of condensate, so an absolutely enormous prize. We established a working hydrocarbon system with our very first one in the basin, something that's a very rare feat, and something that has set us on track now to drill out the rest of the basin. We've got an enormous amount of running room now that we've proven that the hydrocarbons are present in the basin. And Makuyu 2, which will spud in the next couple of weeks, we're out to confirm a discovery in the Makuyu prospect. We've got some data that's come back from Makuyu 1. Unfortunately, we couldn't get our ultimate prize of getting a fluid sample and formally declaring a discovery. But with Makuyu 2, we are more prepared for this next well. We've got calibration points in the basin. We've been able to design our well and our program around some hard data finally, now that there's a well that's being drilled. We've got an exciting play, the basin margin play that we call, which has got what's colloquially known in the region as a string of pearls play. So that's multiple prospects up against the basin bounding fault, which looks very similar to your typical East African rift system, successful in Uganda and Kenya, where multi-billion barrels have been discovered. In Zimbabwe, we've been able to progress very, very quickly from a frontier country where this has never been done before. We entered 4 years ago, and within that period, we've managed to drill one well, shoot two big infill seismic campaigns, and now drilling a second well, and that includes 18 months that was interrupted by COVID. So we move very quickly, we get after things, and we've had a conducive environment to do that. We've got a very experienced board and management team, both from an oil and gas perspective and also from a Zimbabwean business perspective. And that has been bolstered recently by the addition of our new chairman, John Bentley, who's a legend in the African oil scene. He's been involved with some of the most successful explorers and developers and producers, and built and sold multiple companies. Robin Sutherland, our new NED, who's come on board, is one of the rainmakers at Tullo, who is responsible for some of the most notable discoveries in Africa, including the Jubilee field, as well as those multi-billion barrel discoveries in Kenya and Uganda. So he's been a fantastic addition to our team, and we've learned a lot and leveraged on his experience from those campaigns. Joe Matizwa, our deputy chairman, is one of the most prominent business identities in Zimbabwe, and helps us navigate and get things done on the ground. And Barry Meikle, our country manager there as well, very experienced in the oil patch, having worked for Total and Intoil and PNG, a far more difficult environment than Zimbabwe. So we've got a very well-rounded team, and we've progressed this opportunity very quickly. Our acreage portfolio consists of those three permits, and in the middle, you can see that big Makuyu structure. So we... Makuyu 1, which we drilled earlier this year, was on the southern flank of the structure, and we're going up more towards the Horst in Makuyu 2, we've planned. We've got a huge play fairway that we'll be exploring over the coming years. We've just shot some additional 2D seismic data in through this area, and we've got a bunch of drill-ready prospects in the space and margin play here, which already has 1.2 billion barrels of potential. And highly repeatable on success. So what's exciting is that we've proven that hydrocarbons are present in the basin and in Makuyu, and now this opens up the rest of the running room in our portfolio, and we control all the running room with our dominant position. Looking closer at Makuyu 1 and the results, a very, very pleasing result for the very first one in the basin. This, as I said earlier, this doesn't often happen. We had our challenges, as you'd expect, going into a brand new basin that is has never been drilled before, and it's never been done before. So from the logistics aspect, from the geology aspect, we've learned a huge amount from Makuyu 1, and we've applied all of that knowledge now to Makuyu 2 in our planning. And through this well now, we understand the geology, how the rocks are going to behave, and manage to design our program around that. So. As our pre-drill estimate came out last year, we have got the geology right, which is an amazing feat for a basin that hadn't been drilled before. And our primary target in the upper Angwa will be coming back now to prove that up, as well as the prospectivity in the Pebbly Arcos and in the upper Dandy as well. Makuyu 2, now that we've had some calibration in the basin from Makuyu 1, we've refined our seismic interpretation and data and picked Makuyu 2 in a little bit further to the north in a horse block. So we were, on reflection, relatively far down dip of the structure in Makuyu 1. And so in Makuyu 2, we're going to be roughly 450 meters up dip from Makuyu 1, which on success allows us to prove up a pretty substantial resource. So the fact that we've got, we observed hydrocarbons all the way to the base of Makuyu 1 throughout the upper Angwa. So that really does open up a huge amount of potential for us. This location was also picked so that we can test the lower Angwa in this location as well, which we couldn't reach with our previous well. So a much simpler well design. It's only a 12 degree deviated well. We got pretty aggressive with Makuyu 1 with a fairly inclined well that we were drilling so that we could test all of those facies and horizons. But now we've got a much easier well to drill on Makuyu 2. So as we mentioned, we've got quite a reasonable step out from Makuyu 1, roughly 7 kilometers away, which is pretty substantial, and 450 meters up dip. So we do have the ability to prove up a very large resource with this next well. We're going to be testing all of those horizons above the upper Angwa and the lower Angwa as well. And we've refined our drilling program and our well design that will enable us on success to suspend this well and then come back and test it next year. And beyond that, we'll be going into some a pilot scheme and then getting after the appraisal of this field very aggressively with some 3D seismic and additional drilling. So this Makuyu structure, I beg your pardon, absolutely enormous feature. It's 200 square kilometers under closure. So when we say it's one of the largest features going around on onshore Africa, there aren't many bigger things that you can go and find. And that is the advantage of opening up a brand new basin, is that typically you can get to these bigger ones first. Our new 2D seismic campaign has been completed on the eastern portion of our acreage in EPO 1848 and some into 1849. The reason that we've done that after the success in Makuyu 1, I keep getting these buttons wrong. After the success in Makuyu 1, we see a continuation of this play trend along this basement high, and see some very interesting amplitudes that we picked up on the legacy mobile 2D data when mobile explored here in the early 90s. We've got some very nice responses. So this is one of the leads, Macabel, that we've already identified, and this is a roughly 10-kilometer feature that has a very nice amplitude response here and flattens out and conforms with the structure. So a number of these exist in the CPO area, and so we're looking at maturing those with some work that's going on the processing and interpretation, and having some additional drill-ready candidates that will be ready next year as part of a wider exploration and appraisal campaign. Onto the basin margin, which we haven't spoken about yet. This is the string of pearls play, and as I mentioned, we've got a number of these that form these structures up against the basin bounding fault through here, and you can see that we get these gentle little rollovers into the basin bounding fault, which forms these nice closures. So on success, if we open up this play as well with a well and success, it really does provide us with a huge amount of running room and repeatability across the license area. And that's again what's really exciting, is the scale of what we have and the potential that it holds. Zimbabwe, as a jurisdiction to operate in, has provided us with a conducive environment, believe it or not. There have been some pro-business reforms that have been brought in, and as I mentioned, we've been able to mature our project and the company very, very quickly compared to a lot of jurisdictions. The government has put in the necessary reforms and the legislation that have enabled us to do it. Things like special economic zone status, which provide us with a host of fiscal and non-fiscal incentives, and also treat us almost as a quasi-independent state within the country. We're insulated from the local financial system, and it provides a range of benefits as well to our contractors as well that come into the country. We've already signed the petroleum exploration development production agreement, and we're just awaiting the finalization of the fiscal terms and the fiscal agreement that goes on top of that, which will allow us then to provide the country with its fair share of resources. At the moment, Zimbabwe has the best fiscal regime on the planet for oil and gas, but we're looking to do the right thing and provide the state with a fair share of the bounty. So, as I mentioned, we've been able to progress this very quickly. We've done it very systematically, putting in place all of the necessary technical, commercial, and above ground foundations that we need to rapidly develop this project on success. We've got the legislation in place. We've got the commercial viability of this demonstrated through some gas sale MOUs that we've already signed with existing gas buyers in Zimbabwe. There's a hungry market. I'll go through that in a second. Technically, we've been able to get after this project very quickly, drilling a well and shooting two infill seismic campaigns within 4 years, and about to commence our Rikuyu 2 well. Next year, we're looking at a very aggressive program with some 3D seismic and exploration appraisal drilling in Rikuyu and some of those other prospects, which will be drill ready and mature to go next year. Looking at the market, and really we're in an area that we have a huge energy crisis, both from an electricity and also a gas market crisis. A lot of you will be well aware of the electricity shortages in South Africa and what's known as load shedding, where the power is cut. That happens now on a virtual daily basis. 2022 was a record year of power cuts, and 2023, that graph is current to the 10th of May, so by now that's already been surpassed. So current supply shortfall of roughly 7,000 megawatts of power, equivalent to over 1 billion cubic feet per day of gas. The Southern Africa Power Pool, which Zimbabwe is connected to, allows us and provides us with a virtual gas pipeline through the electricity network to commercialize gas through that power network. And the spine of that grid runs through Zimbabwe. On a gas supply perspective, South Africa is also running short of gas. All of their gas comes from onshore Mozambique. Pundit Tamano now is very mature and falling off plateau. 200 plus industrial customers will get cut off from 2026. So facing a gas supply deficit on top of the electricity deficit of 1 billion cubic feet per day by 2030. So again, a huge market for us. We've got an electricity network through the Southern Africa Power Pool. We've got gas pipelines. We've got small-scale LNG and rail and road that we can get gas to customers all over the region. It's it doesn't matter how much gas we discover, we'll be able to monetize every single molecule. So power generation, petrochemicals, fertilizer, industrial, mining houses, as well as liquid fuels, all of them are hungry, and all of them are knocking on our door now looking for supply. And Chrissy is about to chase me off stage, so I'll just wrap up in saying we've got a huge and exciting period ahead of us. This will be a company making couple of months, and very exciting that we get to carry on with Rikuyu 2 and looking at a very exciting period beyond that as well. And next year, hopefully, we'll be back talking about a successful Rikuyu 2 well and what comes next. So thank you.
Excellent. And between this year and next year, you can come to me. We'll do presentation training, and I'll teach you what 15 minutes looks like.
But I have a lot to say.
I know you have a lot to say, but I wasn't sure if I should tackle you or not, because being from Zimbabwe, do you play?
You're talking about rugby?
Yeah, do you play that?
I'm not no longer, but rugby is my religion.
Yes, I didn't want to, just in case you took me out. Good on you, mate. Thanks so much. Thank and you. It is a lot to say. It is a lot to say. Before our next presenter jumps up on stage, can I just show you, Shane, do you have that photo that I gave to you? Do you have that picture? Aha, all right, so have a look at this picture up here. And there, right in the centre here, this gentleman just here, I don't know if you recognise him, I want you to focus on this fella here, under Dumela, and the fellow at the back with the stripy tie. Okay, so the fellow in the centre is the president of Botswana. I'll have a crack at his name, Mogwetisi Masisi. Now, he's been in Perth for Africa Down Under, and to actually have him here in Perth was a real coup, so he actually gave the opening address. And that fellow behind him is one of ours. That is Kris Martinick. He's the CEO and founder of Botala Energy, and he's coming up here to chat with us now. So I'm sure he'll explain that photograph in a little bit more detail to us. But Botala Energy is focused not only on the development of sustainable and reliable energy in South Africa, they've also just made a really big announcement this week in regards to their project, which is in
Botswana,
hence the entree to this one. So without any further ado, would you please make him welcome? We'll hear about the project and more. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, we got very lucky actually yesterday to spend, we were told we would get 5 minutes with the president. We ended up getting nearly half an hour of his time walking through our project and what it means for Botswana. Taking into Scott's, one of his last slides there, which talked about the market and how desperate it was for energy and this energy vacuum. So Eskom has collapsed, someone has to fill that void. There's a great grid, there's a great market there ready to go. So so I'm here to represent Botala Energy. We're a relatively new player on the market. We listed on the Australian Stock Exchange last year in July. Botala is the Setswana word for blue and green. We find in this day and age, not many people understand the difference between blue and green energy. So we're Botala. It's a mix. It depends on what you're talking about. Botala sky, it's blue. Botala grass is green. So we're Botala. It also means success. So in terms of our company, since we listed, we were run privately prior to that. We started this program just before COVID. We funded that by ourselves. It was privately funded. We then listed. And since then, we've done two additional wells after having five wells done privately, two done since we listed. We've now spudded our first commercial pilot. We announced that last on Monday. We spudded that on Friday. We also flared our first gas on Tuesday, so we made that announcement. So we're really rapidly progressing this project. That's quite a lot of work that we have done in a year to take this project through to flaring. We have, at the seventh well we drilled, which we drilled several months ago, we are now actively starting to, we've got skids moving from Queensland to start the flow testing on that well later this year. I guess in terms of what we see here, we listed, we were at 20 cents, we're now at 13 cents, a lot of value. We've done everything that we said we would do. We're about to start our commercial pilot program. So there's significant value that we've got here. We're half the price, we've significantly de-risked the play. The other aspect here that we've got, it's a great jurisdiction. Botswana would probably be the best jurisdiction on mainland Africa. And so we see that, you know, now's time for us as a company to really capitalize on getting this gas into the marketplace. 420,000 hectares of acreage that we have in our coal bed methane play around the town of Sarawi. There is an existing 90 megawatt power station built to run on gas. That project was built because there is an existing pilot program that was done early 2012, 2013. They actually built a 90 megawatt power station. There was some fallout. They've never seen a molecule of gas. It's waiting for gas. It runs on diesel half an hour a day. So as part of this, we've decided that why drill upstream if we don't know whether or not we can commercialize this gas? We took the approach, we stopped. We've looked at two downstream locations. We know that we have a pilot spot, which is at the town of Sarawi. We can tie into a 66 kV line. We've purchased the land for that spot. We've also purchased land for a much bigger project at Palape. That is our Liupani site. That is the big blue sky. That's when we get this project up and running. Then we went back to drilling. Why bother putting holes in the ground if I don't know that I can commercialize this gas? So we've ticked the box, we're comfortable, we've worked with BPC, Botswana Power Corporation, on how can you tie into this grid, and they're satisfied and they're happy. So we've gone back and explored and appraised the gas, and now we've flared. Just to give you an overview of the project, we've got 420,000 hectares. In terms of what was certified as part of the IPO, we've got 317 BCF of 2C that was certified by Sproul and Associates. That was for our seven, for five wells. We have not yet certified, recertified the two that we've drilled so far. Between Sarawi 1 and Sarawi 2, that's 48 kilometres. Between 7 and 3, that's 26 kilometres. Sarawi 3 is where we just flared, and that's where we've spudded also our first of four pilot wells. Sarawi 7, the skid from Queensland should arrive sometime in October, so effectively 9 months behind, but it's 26 kilometre step out from this site here. We estimate we've maybe explored 5% of our acreage. We know the coal is everywhere. It comes to surface down here at Murrupooly, which is where the Murrupooly coal-fired power station is. So we know coal is everywhere. It's just about further exploration. We actually have three seams. Oh, sorry, let me start before I go to that. This is our major milestone. So we lit the candle up this week. We were very, very excited to get there. It's a great milestone for the company. We knew we had gas, but now this proves that it's actually flammable gas, not just CO2. So we're very excited, and that's really got us, given us a lot more comfort that the pilot project that we spudded should go into commercial flow rate potential. So far, in terms of just, so Sarawi 1, as I said before, was in the north. Sarawi 7 was a well that we drilled right next to Sarawi 1. Sarawi 1 was drilled, Sarawi 1, this well, was drilled back in the day by Strata X. So Ron Prefontaine was the chairman there. So that was the Strata X well. They ran into technical difficulties once they went through the top two seams. They were targeting this Sarawi seam. They stopped. We decided that we really wanted to see what was there. We were very happy with these results. This is 900 metres away. We got good coals in the lower Murrupooly. What we are chasing primarily is this target, is the Sarawi seam. It's very gaseous. It's quite good perm. We didn't realise there was this upper Murrupooly. We hadn't seen that. So in our drilling, we were starting to see this thicken in our region. And the lower Murrupooly is what you tend to see also going to the south, where we've got Talao's acreage, who are also an ASX-listed company. So what you've got here is a distance between these two wells of that 26 kilometres with the seams consistent throughout. Project Pitsey, this is our inaugural commercial pilot program. Sarawi 3, or what we've now named the Sarawi 3-1, that sits up here in the north. That's where the evaporation pond is. It's right next to the road. That's the one we just flared. We're doing our four pilot wells. Sarawi 2, S-2, is the first well that we just started to drill. The central one will be the main producer and the commercial pilot that we will test to see the commercial flow rate potential from this region. This is quite an exciting project for us. In terms of our timeline, we have just started drilling. We'll do back-to-back drilling of the four wells. We will perforate those and waiting for our gear to arrive. We're purchasing this also again from our flow testing skids from Queensland, from Acarat. They'll arrive. We should have it into commissioning and production sometime next year. That's water production, dewatering, and then assessing the flow rate from there. So exciting times for us as a company. We're very, very much progressing with trying to get this through into the next phase, which is production and conversion of the mining license. So through our normal decision trees, we started with Sarawi 3 flow testing. That was a single well. We had gas flowing. We've moved into Project Pitsey, which is our four well program. We are now in the process of pulling together all of the documentation that is required to convert from a prospecting license to a mining license that enables us to actually start to sell the gas. We have also, as I said in the earlier slide, we have acquired the two downstream locations. We have 110 hectares in the town of Sarawi where we can establish, and we're very advanced on the environmental impact assessments. So we've done everything in parallel, assuming success. So maybe the horse before the cart, but we're lucky in that regard that the EIAs should be ready by the end of this year for the upstream, and maybe into quarter one next year is where we're going to get the downstream EIAs approved. So we're trying to move that very, very quickly. The EIAs are required for the mining license conversion as well. Serowe 7 flow testing, approximately 9-10 months behind where we're at with Serowe 3, so we should start to see results from that end of mid quarter two starting to come through in terms of the gas bubbling. We've taken our time, we've been incredibly slow and patient with the wells, because coal bed methane, the more patient you are, the better these things handle you. Should we get gas flowing, we'll move into a commercial pilot program. Slim hole drilling, to date, all the wells that we've done have been probably more expensive. Oh, just to bear in mind, Serowe 3, I meant to mention, is open hole. We drilled that for, drilled and completed that for $220,000. So incredibly cheap. That's open hole to all three seams. So we're not talking expensive drilling here. We're not talking $1 million per well, $220,000 for that well. Slim hole drilling, we know we can do for much less. We want to do that further to get out into that acreage. Like I said, we've only really drilled 5% of our acreage. We know there have been gas producers in the area. So we want to go and test our acreage right near those locations. And we actually want to now that we've got access to a lab, we're going to do some further desorption testing. To date, we've used nuclear magnetic resonance, which is a tool that was available in the country. Labs weren't. We now have access to a lab. We're going to do some cores, and we want to do 4 to 5 slim holes around our acreage to really start to get an idea of where we want to put the next exploration well going forward. So quite exciting in that regard. I'm really keen to test some of the eastern side of our acreage where we have limited data. We've more got the analog data from and what we the hearsay from neighbours. Binding MOU with Solar Finland. Why a binding MOU with Solar Finland? This doesn't make sense. You're a gas company. Well, no, we are a diversified energy company. We have always established ourselves through our name of Botala. We always had multi-pronged approach to our business model. Yes, our main undertaking is gas, but we have always made sure that we can monetize the gas, and that would always be through solar and gas. Solar and gas are a great hybrid power system when batteries don't make sense, when the sun's shining, solar is producing at 4 cents a kilowatt hour, significantly reducing your CO2 emission, but also your cost of production. So we went out as gas guys to find a solar partner. We found Solar Finland. Solar Finland approached us as well and said, look, we'd love to supply you with solar panels, but we're also looking at expanding globally with putting a manufacturing base in each of the continents. We've got one being constructed now. They've just commissioned it in Thailand. They've got another plant being started up in Mexico. We snagged the one in Botswana and said, hey, we've got a site for you. So we're the project developer. We would take a slice in the project, but really we wanted to bring them to country and establish them within Botswana. It has been the biggest and the best door opener for business development you could imagine. It has got us through to fantastic links to Finnish funds, to green funds, to government bodies. Every stakeholder in Botswana is dying for industry to set itself up, especially New Age industry. So yes, we've taken a small slice of this. We're project developer, so we're designing things, putting the environmental permits in place. We're not going to be the main owner of this. That's not our role. Our role is to establish it and get it in place. We'll take a slice and we'll help it out. But this opens doors, and it has opened doors to everywhere for us. So for our perspective, it's been a great business model. It is a good business model. But where we want to see that leveraged is actually using those panels for when we can get it into production, should the gas flow at a commercial flow rate. So the Solar Finland aspect for us, it's not our core business. It's not meant to be our core business, the gas is, but it is an exceptionally good bit of business development for us. Kilaboha. So that is my presentation. I do have the whole team here, so including the board of directors. So if anyone wants to chase us up for some questions, we will be around. We do have an experienced board. I didn't go through it, but a lot of the board have spent numerous years in South Africa and Southern Africa, and very, very well versed on what we need to do in that area. Thank you.
Stay there. Stay there. And we know what he plays, don't we? plays that rugby game. And I think actually Stu may have been a bit cunning when he put together this particular conference, because where are you next week?
What are
you doing for the next 2 weeks? What's anyone that plays rugby doing for the next 2 weeks?
Oh, we'd be watching the World Cup.
You'd be watching the World Cup. You wouldn't be here at all. Can you do a bit of work on the side for all these projects here, though? That would be handy.
Lucky the World Cup's at night, so it's late in the early in the morning. Yeah, so
you'd be like, do you remember that year they had the soccer and they had the cycling on at the same time in France that year? I was doing breakfast with ABC Radio and I was absolutely shattered at the end of those 2 weeks, nearly killed me. Well done, congratulations, and well done on your meeting with the president as well. That's very impressive. Put your hands together, please, for the team. Botala Energy. Now, we should technically be whipping straight across to our next presentation. As he gets ready to come up, though, I've just seen one of our supporters up the back. Gloria, would you like to come up here? So, Gloria Zhang in Tlang, and as you came in on the far side of our exhibition hall, you would have seen Gloria's booth. Now, Gloria is an amazing human being. She is an absolute dynamo, speaks multiple languages, but of course her focus, Chinese and English. And she is the person that you want to speak to if you want to do anything in China. I know a little bit more about international relations. She also knows a lot about really good wine. So she has taken a bottle of Penfolds 407, and I'll pass the microphone over to you because it's a little surprise, isn't it?
Yes, it is a surprise. And I'm pretty sure through the VE conference, we're looking after everyone's wealth very carefully. And I'm also promoting wealth and health and happiness. So this little bottle of wine, drinking wine is supposed to be very good for heart if you drink the right quantity. So, but definitely with the amount of interest received, I believe it makes some people very happy with the family tonight for the well done of the conference.
No, you. I don't know, we're having a fight now. Who's drawing it? My card's in there, so they're not in there, so it doesn't matter. Right, we're stirring around, stirring around. Don't look, do not look in there. That's part of the rules.
And my Chinese staff saying this one's very popular in China. They have eyes on it, yeah. But I told them their cards are not allowed to be in there.
Ah, that's fair enough. Okay. Penfolds 407, about $120. Nice. You have to be over 18 and you have to be in the room. We could be pulling out lots of cards.
Dane Langs. Redraw. Dane Langs. Lens.
All right. What's the Chinese lucky number is?
Number 8.
Number 8. Let's go. We'll go to 8. Go. Next one. What's the next one? Too bad, Dan. All right. Next one is, RM Black. Nice card.
Black, David Marr. David Marr.
Gee, you guys are going to be so sad. Wait for this. We're going to put you up. We'll say, David, there we go. You know, in all honesty, though, I didn't actually give any warning. All right. Aylin Amy from OFX. Aylin Amy? Oh. All right, there we go. Only took us to 3. I thought it was going to be the Chinese lucky number 8. Good luck there getting up there. Nice. This is like OK health and safety nightmare just at the front here. All right. We're getting a photograph. So, Aylin, just checking, do you actually drink red wine?
I love red wine.
Shame. Okay, off you go. Bugger off. Well done. Congratulations to you. Thanks so much. Would you put your hands together for Gloria, please? And go and see the team. If you've got anything that you need to do with China at all, international relations, or just marketing in general, Gloria is your person to get onto there. All right. Let's bring up Vintage Energy. And I was having a bit of a smile when I thought of the name of this company. I'm going to tell you what his sport was first, because Vintage Energy, the man from Vintage Energy, has just played his very last game of his chosen sport in the world, soccer. So the old Vintage Energy, he's hung up his soccer boots this week, which is good because now we can pay more attention to this project, which is going to take a lot of work, because since they presented here last year, they've met their their big target, and their target was first production within 5 years of IPO. Done. Tick, done that one. So they're now supplying gas under long-term contracts to the east coast of Australia. They also possess significant reserves of uncommitted gas in the Cooper Basin. And as we all know, there is a very high demand for those reserves. And they've contracted a second gas field for supply and they expect to begin that this month sometime. I'm sure he's going to tell us maybe perhaps the exact date. Would you please make welcome Michael Dodd, everyone, to update us on Vintage Energy.
Thank you. I'm going to talk to you about the progress of Vintage, disclaimer there. Thanks, Chrissy. So we're only 5 years from listing, and we've got ourselves into an enviable position now where we're able to start seeing the value that we've created by the work, hard work of a really quite a small team, actually, at Vintage. We're only 18 people, and we've gone from being an explorer to a producer in that 5 years since we listed in September 2018. So now, as I say, we're a producer producing into the East Coast gas market, and we're set to see growth now in production because we're just about to bring on our second gas field. So we'll see growth in production, growth in revenue, growth in cash flow. We've also got a substantial amount of gas that isn't contracted yet, and I think that's a great position to be in with the ravenous East Coast gas market. And being a small company, we're also exempt from the $12 gas cap, so a really strong position to be in there. On top of that, I'll go into a bit later, we've got another industrial gas resource that we're looking to commercialize, and we've got a pretty good exploration portfolio as well. So just on that timeline that I mentioned, over the last 5 years, what does that look like? As I said, we listed in 2018, and in 2019, we farmed into ATP 2021 in Queensland with Metgasco. And I think Ken gave a pretty good talk yesterday and talked a bit about some of the assets that I'm going to talk about. So we took 50% of that permit, and Metgasco at the time had the other 50%. They since farmed down 25% of that to Bridgeport. So Metgasco and Bridgeport are our partners there. So if you're excited by Ken's talk, you should be doubly excited by Vintage because we've got 50%. So after we farmed in, we drilled the Vali 1 well, discovered the Vali gas field in January 2020, and we actually discovered Nangwari, which is the industrial gas resource, around about the same time. 2021, we appraised the Vali gas field. And we also discovered the Odin gas field, which is the second field which we're going to bring online. 2022, we signed our first GSA, and onto 2023, and it's just been milestone after milestone this year. We've delivered our first gas to market, collected our first revenue, we've signed our second GSA, we've run a connection project for the Odin gas field. And production from that is imminent. So all that activity over those years amounts to some 100,000 man hours in the field, and we've done that with no lost time injuries and no environmental incidents. So we're very, very proud of that record. We've got a portfolio which is very strongly aligned to our East Coast gas strategy, with basinal diversity across the eastern part of onshore Australia. Our production is currently focused in the Cooper Basin, but we've got other exploration and appraisal assets around the place, in the Otway Basin, both South Australia and Victoria, in the Galilee Basin in Queensland, onshore Bonaparte in the Northern Territory. And I'll walk through this portfolio a little bit more. So a little bit about the Vali gas field. This was our inaugural revenue generator. It's really an appraisal by production project. After we drilled the first three wells on the field, we booked a gross 101 petajoules of 2P reserve, 50% of which is vintage. And that's in Patchawarra and Toolachee reservoirs. So the Patchawarra, we fracture stimulate, and the Toolachee free flows. So the next step for us was, at the same time as generating revenue, we would assess the, try to understand better the performance of individual wells, so that we could use that to get a full field development model together. To this end, we designed and built a separation and metering facility. We got the three wells connected and struck our first GSA with AGL for between 9 and 16 PJs up to December 26. So that actually leaves us with on a gross basis with another 85 PJs of uncontracted gas already for the East Coast market, and remembering again that we're exempt to the price cap. So we achieved first gas with Vali 1 in February this year, and that zone's produced to forecast ever since. The facility has been really reliable, 98% plus, and we've had a couple of issues with Vali 2, Vali 3, but we're pursuing solutions to establish stable flow from those two wells as we speak. The Odin gas field set to make a positive change to vintage really imminently. So this field will be online this month. It was discovered in 2021, and it's just to the west of Vali field, just a few kilometres. It's got 39 PJs of a 2C resource, and we flow tested this well from the Toolachee and Epsilon. So this well discovered gas in three zones: Toolachee, Epsilon, and Patchawarra. And as I say, the well test was from the Toolachee and Epsilon combined. We got 6.5 million a day from that well test, which is pretty good going for the Cooper Basin these days. So we're currently in the very final stages of a fast track connection project. So we'll connect it into the midline risers on the Vali export line. The Vali export line connects into Santos infrastructure at Beckler Field, and then onwards through Dullangarry and into Moomba. Gas from Odin is contracted to the Pelican Point Power, which is an Orange Mitsui joint venture. And we've recently received authorization from the ACCC to further contract gas beyond 2024. So now for something completely different. Nangwari is a substantial carbon dioxide discovery and capable of producing for multiple decades. It's located in the southeast of South Australia. We were actually targeting conventional gas in a fault band structure. We did get a discovery, but it was carbon dioxide. Initially, when we found that out, we were a bit disappointed. But then, when we looked into it a little bit harder, we found out that carbon dioxide is actually a very valuable industrial gas, and it's actually becoming in quite short supply now. We've got a base case resource of almost 26 BCF, and it was tested at 10 million a day. Just to put it in context, you can see the Caroline 1 well highlighted on that slide there. That was another carbon dioxide well. It produced for 50 years, only recently became depleted and abandoned. It was the record royalty producing well of all time for the South Australian government. So you can see that we can make money out of this resource. So it's really good quality carbon dioxide here. And it's a really valuable resource for two reasons. It's in short supply, and secondly, the food grade carbon dioxide has got a lot of uses. It's in short supply because a lot of the carbon dioxide that's used in industrial gases these days is captured from gas-fired power generation or manufacturing processes. And as those as we try and decarbonize those, they're becoming used less and less, so the supply becomes more intermittent, and there's the constant supply of this, the source of this gas, has really been dried up. But it's needed. We need it for medical purposes, for food and beverage, for firefighting, for horticulture, and the flow rates that came from that well are more than capable of sustaining, say, a 150 ton a day plant, which would be about 10% of Australia's demand. The other good thing about Nangwari is there was a little bit of methane in the stream as well, which is just about enough to power a plant. So it's a good resource we've got there. A few words on the rest of the portfolio. From an exploration point of view, we've really concentrated on production to now, but there's a number of assets at the other end of the funnel. Bonaparte, we've got a well there called Cullen 1, which was an exploration well probably 6-7 years ago, and that found had really good gas shows in an extensive carbonate section, which was naturally fractured. So our intention is to go back and test that well. In the Galilee, we got along with our partners Comet Ridge, we got the first measurable gas flow from the deep section there. We've got a 2C resource of 46 PJs for our 30% working interest. Unfortunately, the work we were doing on the Albany field there was halted by COVID, and we haven't got back to that, but we've recently been awarded PCAs, which gives us longevity of tenure to do work around the Albany field and also exploration prospects that are in that area. We've got acreage in the Otway Basin, both in South Australia and Victoria. PET 171 in Victoria is an extension of the Panola Trough, which has produced all the gas that's been produced from the Otway Basin in South Australia to date. So there's a number of upcoming events that add value to the proposition of Vintage, starting with the Odin field. As I said, that's the most imminent one. We've got startup of production from that field within this month. Probably within the next week or so. We've got the ability now for that field to contract gas beyond 2024, and we'll be preparing for further drilling on the field. At Varley, we've got ongoing production from Varley 2 and planning interventions on Varley 2 and Varley 3. And Nangwari will continue engagement around commercialization of that resource. So we'll just finish up with a wrap up of the main takeaways. So number one is that production and thus revenue and cash flow are about to grow for Vintage with the imminent startup of the Odin field. Secondly, we're in a great position to take advantage of the East Coast gas market because we've got oodles of uncontracted gas just waiting for customers. And remembering again that we're exempt from the cap. Plus, we've got all that exploration acreage to backfill the portfolio. And thirdly, just to repeat, Nangwari is a sizable and very valuable resource of industrial gas. We don't want to see South Australia run out of beer anytime soon. So it will be valuable to us. And thank you very much for listening.
Well done. Now what are you going to do without soccer on the weekend?
I don't know.
You don't know.
I'll have better Mondays, I can tell you that. It's hard work chasing around people 20 or 30 years younger than yourself.
Yes, you can go and make us more money. We'll be happy with that outcome. Good on you. Well done. Thank you so much. Okay. Now, team, we have got, what have we got to go now? I think we've got three, don't we? We do. Vintage, TMK, Airborne, and... It's getting on even thinner ice. The big man's going to be rounding us out today, so that should be an interesting one. I hope to see all of you in here and more at the very end. We've been to Cuba, we've been to Africa, Indonesia, Australia. We're headed to Mongolia now with TMK Energy to a site 20 kilometres from the China-Mongolia border. It's close to the extensive northern China gas transmission and distribution network. It's close to several large-scale mining operations with really high energy needs. Who want this? They want it. It's that, now we're going to say it correctly, Gavanti's 35 project, yep. Yes? And for the last few weeks, had sustained gas flow achieved at three of their pilot wells. Look at how happy this fella is. There's been a lot of happy presenters up here this week. The company involved is happy. If you're a shareholder, I'm going to guess that you are happy already. Everything is going as planned, if not a little quicker from all the reports that I have read. To talk us through this prospect in the South Gobi Basin, would you please welcome their CEO, Brendan Stats.
Okay, well, hello, and thanks for sticking around. I think this is the last corporate presentation for today, so I assume you've been waiting all day for this one, so thanks very much. Thanks to RIU for the opportunity to present today and for the introduction, Chrissy. Thanks very much. So my name is Brendan Stats. I'm the CEO of TMK Energy, and as mentioned, TMK is focused on developing our world-class coal seam gas project in the South Gobi Basin of Mongolia. So I've got a lot of slides today to get through, and I've got to get through them quickly before Chrissy kicks me off. But I just wanted to start on this one, talking about the highlights of the project. And I guess the question is, why are we in Mongolia, and why are we looking for coal seam gas in Mongolia? And I think the answer really is because of the potential for Mongolian coal seam gas, and specifically referencing the size, the quality, and the location of this project. And so in terms of size, what I'm talking about is both geographically, it's 8,500 square kilometres, so a very large area geographically, but more importantly, the size of the resource or the size of the prize. So we have a total 2C plus 2U of 6.5 trillion cubic feet of gas, and so it's a giant resource. And I think really when you're chasing multi-TCF scale projects of this size and prospectivity, they're difficult to find, but Mongolia really presents this opportunity. Secondly, in terms of the quality of the project, so Mongolia is well known for large coal deposits, which are mined in the South Gobi region and a large export of coal to China. And what we really see is Mongolia today is really analogous to Queensland 20 years ago, where Queensland had a long history of coal mining, a lot of exploration, well-developed coal mining, and they really started looking at the coal seam gas potential of Queensland, say, circa 20 years ago. And within that 20 years, Queensland coal seam gas is really developed, and today is tens of billions of dollars worth of coal seam gas going out of Queensland. And so we're right at the start of the journey in Mongolia, but I think encouragingly what we're seeing in Mongolian coals is that some of the key attributes required for coal seam gas are equal to or better than the coals that we have in Queensland. And so that's very good. And then the last point really is the location. So the location of the project is right on the border with China. You can literally see China from the project area, close to gas infrastructure in northern China. And so China's largest energy importer in the world. And so being located so close to the market gives us a real advantage in terms of cost of delivery. Coal seam gas from Queensland ends up in China, but that's very high cost of delivery. Even the other importers of energy into China are from pipelines several thousand kilometres away. So there's a real advantage there. But there's also a real energy demand for cleaner energy and reliable energy in Mongolia itself. And so there's fortunately, really strategically well located close to existing markets. So just onto a couple of the investment highlights, and I'll try and talk to some of these points through the presentation in more detail, if I have time. But yeah, the first one, we've got the largest gas for 2C contingent resource in Mongolia. So it's a great place to start. I mentioned we're close to large markets in China, and there's markets in the South Gobi with the mining operations. The South Gobi region of Mongolia is the premier mining jurisdiction there. A lot of high energy users located in the South Gobi. I'll just point to the existing data set we have of 2,500 drill holes from a lot of the work that's been done over the last 20 years in the coal exploration and mining. And what that means for us is that we've significantly de-risked the project. We understand the geology very well through this data set, and it's a real head start. 2,500 drill holes probably cost you about $250 million to drill. And so it's a $250 million data set, but more importantly, it saves you a lot of time. And And that's why we've been able to move the project forward very successfully and very quickly. What else should I focus on here? The initial data that we've collected really points to a world-class coal seam gas project. And I guess just where we're at today, we've got a very active next 6 months where we're hoping to take the project through some key development milestones. So it's a very exciting time for the company. We're well funded through that work program. And I think our track record points to the ability that, of TMK to actually deliver on our goals. And so, it's an exciting time for the company. I won't go into too much detail on the corporate snapshot, but what you can see is that we're well funded. $6.5 million in the bank as of the last quarter, which will, I should point out that exploration costs in Mongolia are very, very low. So that money goes a long way in terms of taking the project forward. Market cap there around 65 to 70 million. And just on our register, about board and management have about 50% of the shares on issue, so significant skin in the game from the board and management. And the other one is significant Mongolian ownership of the shares. About 50% of the shares are held by Mongolians. So I think that points to that we've got a really strong interest, a local interest in the project, and also in endorsement of the project. Just quickly on the management and the board, we've both Australians and Mongolians on the board and the management team, which I think is important when you're developing a project in Mongolia. And we've actually got a few of the directors here in the crowd today, and including Gemma, who's come from Mongolia. So if you haven't caught up with, and John Warburton's over there, so if you haven't caught up with them, it's a great opportunity to ask those guys some questions. If there's more information about TMK or the project or Mongolia in general, those guys, I'd encourage you to catch up with those guys, and they've probably got a different perspective to me, so great chance to catch up with them. Regarding myself, I'm a geologist. I've worked on and off in Mongolia for the last 12 years. And my expertise is really in coal and coal seam gas. And I've been involved in this project since its inception. Now, I don't want to blow my own trumpet here, but I just wanted to point out that we have been able to move the project forward very quickly and very successfully over the last 18 months. So TMK acquired the project about 18 months ago. And since then, we've drilled the first exploration program very quickly and very successfully. We've got a maiden contingent resource of 1.2 TCF, and we've more recently we've drilled three production wells as a pilot well program and brought those wells online a couple of months ago, and we're now flaring, flowing gas to surface and flaring. So it's been a very successful last 18 months, and I think what that points to is, one, it points to the quality of the project. The ability to move the project forward is obviously thanks to the geology. It all comes down to the geology in the end, but also the team. TMK's been able to take the project forward very successfully. So this is a summary of the exploration results that we obtained last year from the maiden exploration program. And yeah, I'm a geologist, and so I've got to be careful not to go into too much detail and rabbit on and waste my 15 minutes. But this really is the crux of the project is in the geology. And Mongolian coal geology is quite unique in a number of ways, but importantly for us, the special characteristics are really that the coal seams there are very, very thick, much thicker than coal seams in Australia, but also very gassy. So very, very unique and obviously very good for coal seam gas. And what that means is that there's a lot of gas in the ground, and that's what the exploration program last year demonstrated, and what the maiden contingent resource demonstrated. So just onto that maiden contingent resource that was delivered last year on the back of that exploration program. 1.2 TCF, the largest 2C in Mongolia. But I'll just try and put that into perspective. 1.2 TCF is at $10 a gigajoule is about $13 billion worth of gas. If produced at 50 petajoules a year, that's a 25-year production at 50 petajoules. So I guess my point is it's a big number. And that contingent resource number is delivered from a very modest exploration program last year and from an area of less than 1% of the total project area. So, yeah, enormous resource. As I said, a lot of gas in the ground, but there's plenty of upside and exploration potential within the remaining 8,500 square kilometres. And I guess this chart's just trying to illustrate really what I mean by a lot of gas in the ground. And the chart on the left is comparing the energy per unit area or per square kilometre, and what we've got is we've got are three well-known CSG fields from around the world: the Powder River Basin, the Surat in the US, the Surat and Bowen Basins in Australia, and they typically operate at 4 to 6 BCF per square kilometre. And these are very successful coal seam gas basins. And what we've got up in the top right there is the Gavantes project, at running at 33 BCF per square kilometre. So that talks to a very, very high energy density or resource density. And that's purely a function of that unique geology that I mentioned, the very, very thick coals and very, very gassy coals. And looking forward, what that points to is simple, low cost development and high operating margins. So onto the plan for this year. So we've got three key aspects of the plan this year. The first one's being the pilot well program, which the key aim is to flow gas to surface and at commercial rates. And I'll go into more detail in a minute. The second is an exploration program, which we've just recently kicked off. And the third aspect is early commercialization. So I mentioned there's existing high energy users in the South Gobi, and we've already got an offtake agreement for any gas we produce from this pilot well program to supply the local mines with energy, which they're desperate for. But I think the key one really is the pilot well program. I think we've demonstrated that there's a lot of gas in the ground, and now the question is, can we get the gas out and at what rates? And that talks to the commerciality of the project. And so we successfully drilled the three production wells in May and June this year. And by successfully, I mean they intersected about 60 to 70 metres of coal in the production interval. And I should point out, these are relatively shallow for coal seam gas, between 300 and 500 metres. And they're also simple vertical wells, which in another word means cheap wells. So we recently turned those on about 8 weeks ago. We started pumping, and typically with coal seam gas projects, what you expect is high water rates to begin with, and then over time, the gas rates will build up. And we expect the gas rates to build up over approximately 18 to 24 months as the water rates drop off. But what we've seen so far in the 8 weeks that we've been operating these wells is all the positive signs that we're looking for. What we've seen is good water rates. So we've been pumping, we're up around 600 to 650 barrels of water per day. And what that indicates is good permeability, which also talks to future good gas production. So that's good water rate. But I guess critical to coal seam gas is the ability to dewater the reservoir or depressurize the reservoir to get the gas to flow. And so what we're seeing also is we're able to successfully bring down that reservoir pressure. So that's what we're seeing at the moment. And then the third positive indication is we've got gas to surface. We've on all the three wells, we've got flowing gas to surface and a flare. You can see the flare there, and there's a flare on each of the three wells, and continuously flaring from the three wells. And the gas rates are low at the moment, but that's what we expect to build up over the 18 months. But so I think we've got a very exciting 6 months ahead of us with the production testing from these pilot wells as we see those rates build. I'll have to speed up a bit, I think. But the exploration program we kicked off two weeks ago. The dark blue box is where we did the exploration last year, and we've got the pilot wells going now. The lighter blue box is where we're drilling now, and I guess the key point there is it's 100 kilometres away, it's in the same coal measure rocks, and between those two boxes there's well-defined coal fields, and what we really hope to demonstrate is the scale of the project. I've already briefly mentioned that there's significant opportunities for gas in Mongolia, and we see gas playing a very important role in the transition and growth of the Mongolian energy market, addressing some of the really big concerns there around energy independence, security and reliability. So I think there's a great market for gas in Mongolia. I think the energy thematic in China is well understood, huge appetite for energy and a particular appetite for gas. And so we're well located to, well exposed to that market. Just quickly on Mongolia in general, I'm not sure how many have been to Mongolia, but I think it's a great place to work, and their economy is really underpinned by their resource industry, and there's a lot of support from the top down to get these resource projects off the ground and developed. You heard from Colby yesterday for Talon. They're our partner, 33% interest in the project, been involved in the project for a number of years, and we're also we've got an exploration license and a production sharing contract with Mongolian government, which really sets the fiscal terms for the exploration, also the development of the project. And in summary, I think they're very competitive with other jurisdictions around the world. So I guess I just wanted to wrap up, and in terms of an investment opportunity, I think we've got a world-class project there in Mongolia. And over the next 3-6 months or even a year, I think we're going to go a long way to proving up the potential of the project and take it through some real key development milestones. And probably the most important one at this point is really the commercial gas rates to surface, which is what we hope to see in the next 6 months. With the exploration program to demonstrate scale, and we're fully funded through these work programs. So thanks very much for your time today. And I guess if you're interested, well, we'll be around. And as always, anytime, reach out if there's any more questions. So thanks very much.
What's your sport, Brendan? What's your sport?
No sport anymore, but I enjoy my AFL.
You're a watcher.
Watching these.
Watcher. Videos. All right, good on you. Well done. All right, back in the 50s, two speeches to go. Back in the 50s, geophysical technology called airborne electromagnetics was introduced and enabled us to map groundwater resources throughout the world. So what would happen is a helicopter, for those not familiar with it, a helicopter would fly up and it would go in sort of lawnmower patterns across the ground, and it dangles a little sensor beneath it. They need to be about 35 meters above the ground, and it measures electrical conductivity. So how is that used in the oil and gas industry? I don't know. This man knows. Alex Zhan, would you please make him welcome, everyone? He's going to give us his insights on behalf of the Geological Survey of Western Australia.
Right, thank you. I'm a geophysicist. I'm from Geological Survey of Western Australia. So my topic is airborne electromagnetic surveys in WA. GSWA and Geoscience Australia work together to acquire regional AEM data to provide the pre-competitive data set for explorations in WA. And we have rolled out the surveys during the COVID period and reached the full coverage across the state thanks to the money from EFTF of the Commonwealth Government and also EIS from the state government. The data consists of multiple surveys and thousands of lines, and all the lines have been released in March this year. So because the petroleum industry relies on seismic quite heavily, and the AEM seems not so relevant to the industry, so I'd like to provide some sort of a context for the acquisition and processing. The AEM utilize aircraft, either fixed wing or helicopter, to tow a large horizontal loop and a smaller receiver sort of bird beneath and to collect the data. So obviously the advantages are the easy access and much lower cost compared to the seismic surveys. The principle is the same as a metal detector, which uses a big sand group, a big sand coil, to generate a primary EM field, and that will receive a secondary field coming back from the coins or gold nuggets. So by using that device, we can sort of gauge what kind of objects underneath and how deep they are. So this is the basic Faraday's law and has been used in our daily life. You can see when we pass through security check at the airport and also charge the phone wirelessly and use your induction cooktop. So this is all the same principles. The only sophisticated part about the AEM is it has evolved from the frequency domain to a time domain data, to a time domain system. So the new system is controlled by abruptly turning off a steady current, and that will trigger a secondary current circulating within the dual bodies and quickly decay. So by measuring the current and how it decays, this new system gains a superior sensitivity in detecting weak signals compared to the old frequency domain system. The data is massive, and it was impossible to complete a thorough interpretation at both regional and field scales in a timely manner. So what I did was to select about 20 localities and incorporate the data with other type of data such as at the Johor, barrel geology, seismic, gravity, magnetic data, all kinds of data to see what the AEM can provide and enhance the geological understanding of the area. And those features, 20 features have been put into report 234, which is now available to download. For example, one of the localities is Hardman Syncline of the Old Basin. The basin has been poorly, very lightly explored, like Oak Dirks 1. This is for the petroleum resources and some sort of mineral resources as well. The basin, the geology of the basin is poorly understood due to the lack of seismic data. And this AEM data provides the first vertical profile to resolve the geometry of the basin. So, for example, we can zoom in the north line and find the structure here. So what I found is the geology is just highly consistent with this conductivity, and also the well intersection of a very thick shale and a little bit volcanics at the bottom just match the conductivity so beautifully. So that consistency from both lateral and vertical perspectives just give us a confidence to further chase down this formation boundaries and see what the structure look like. And from here we can see the Devonian is about 300 meters thick. The Cambrian is dipping down towards the west, and this whole basin is displaced by this White Mountain Fault and Horse Creek Fault to the west. Zoom into another line across the center part of the basin. What we can see is the same kind of consistency. And of course, because it's the center, the Devonian is much thicker. But more interestingly, we can see this Cambrian stuff. They just shallows and thickens towards the east. This is very different from what we typically see in a half graben geometry, where we see the sedimentary section just thickens and deepens towards the boundary fault. So this is very different. This is basically opposite to that. And also the formations of the same age here are heavily deformed. And so that tells us that after the deposition of this stuff, before Devonian, this area probably experienced a sort of compressional or transpressional movement to squeeze the basin and shift the deposit towards west by about 50 kilometers. And also a significant amount of erosion could have occurred to remove lots of Cambrian stuff as well. So coming back to this well, Oak Dirks 1, this is one of the earliest well drilled in WA. And it was based on oil seeps found by Water Ox and Mike Durek. Water Ox was a frontline soldier in France during the World War I. And his fellow American told him, if you find oil seep, you find an oil field, then you become rich man. So he come back home with that cutting edge science and went prospecting in the regional WA. And he did find his oil seep, which was reported as bitumen after the evaporation of the light elements, of course. So nowadays, some people cast the doubts about whether it's real seep or something else. But that doesn't matter. They put that aside. Another specimen was later found by Michael Durek. He's a rich man. He had a big cattle business in the Kimberley, and he had an interest in the petroleum industry as well. So he decided to ship oil rig all the way from Canada to the outback in the Kimberley, and spend a year to drill this well down to 360 meters. So now the 360 meters seems very random to us, that number. But if you put that into a context of drilling time, which is around 10 years after the huge discovery in the Middle East, the Anglo-Persian company, which is a former BP, they struck oil, the huge discovery there, at exactly the same depth. So what I'm thinking is maybe that 360 meters is what they considered as a magical number, or just because of the rig capacity or the budget. Anyway, everything here for the drilling, including the drilling rationale, like the oil seep thing, and the boiler to power the rig, and also the depth of the well, 360 meters, they look very, very primitive by today's standard. But if you look at the structure there, which is now revealed by the AEM data, they actually drilled on a footwall block with a series of faults, potentially serving the migration pathway. And if there was something underneath, it could be sealed by this thick package of shale. So it was a primitive drilling, but it was on a quite sound structure closure there. And what's, you know, something else is quite interesting there, there's sort of intrusion features here with Cenozoic formations on top, and that Cenozoic formations has dips about 20 degrees towards the northeast. So these elevated structures. So my understanding is these elevated structures are related to Cenozoic intrusions. So if that's the case, then the oil seep that water ox or magnetic rocks found near the river might be related to also volcanoes, and they could be real bitumens. So south of that that syncline, there's an area covered by colluvial sediments. So nobody know what they are, and some people think it's a younger cover, and they call it Windu sandstone overlying these volcanics. But this interpretation brings out a dilemma, because in the north, where we know there is the younger cover on top of the volcanics, that MEG data shows the transitional data towards the side. But here, this is different. We can see there's a sharp boundary there between the unknown and the volcanics. So there's something unusual there. Luckily, we got this area covered by the AM data. Now, that unknown section there has a quite high conductivity. It doesn't look like sandstone at all. And instead, this section sort of dips down towards west and it can be correlated to the upper Proterozoic Timberly shale there. There's a little bit of disruption there, which could be either caused by fault displacement or some sort of conductive drainage cast a shadow there. But either way, this stuff is very likely to be Timberly shale. So if the upper Proterozoic is the case for this thing, then all the information will come together that this thing is underlying the volcanics instead of overlying the volcanics. I'm running out of my time now, so I have to flip through some AM sections in different area. Here in the Kimberley, we can see the conductivity on either side of the syncline just match with the geology so beautifully. So we can use AM data to estimate the thickness of those formations. In the physical trough, the data can help map a series of faults in the trough, such as St. George Range, Poor Range, Grand Range, Mount Wynn. And we can also combine the seismic data, the well intersections with the AM data, and figure out that Jones Arc is just one of those anticlines. And that anticline can be grouped into a series of an echelon folds within the trough. So these structures are probably probably have the same structural origin and caused by the fusoid transpression movement. In the officer basin, the wall of Sword Dabia has a clear surface signal, a feature cell there, which is quite circular, and the relatively noisy seismic because it's very shallow there, and quite a clear AM signature. So this storm sort of disrupts the conductivity Permian formation there. In Western Kimberley, the rocks are mainly volcanics, sandstone and dolomite. Those rocks are very resistive. So even though the data are just consistent with the geology, they are just blank without a conductive component, and you can see nothing there. So these sections are just as empty as my bank account, nothing really exciting. And so it's not a silver bullet for all geologists. I'm sorry to say that. The regional AM data has been heavily used for mining industry. So just within a few weeks after the data release, we can see the market release from the mining industry. they're using the data to prioritize the targets and anomalies. For example, a very west dipping feature has been interpreted by the operator as a legitimate bedrock conductor. And so with the geochem analysis, elevated the nickel and copper, the company just acquired a lot more data over the tenement and they prioritized the targets there. Also, another company identified two anomalies in their area and also correlate and something else another anomaly with a known nickel deposit at Cassini. So they think this is quite interesting for the area and acquired a lot more geophysical data as well. The summary, the regional AM data shows high consistency across lines that provide confidence that smaller surveys can be further enhanced the exploration and the mapping. The data just add another dimension and provide a great complement to seismic. Also, as the geophysical property, the AM conductivity is just only a proxy and better to be integrated with other type of data to reduce the uncertainties. Thank you very much.
I like that. AM out to sum that up very, very quickly. Thank you so much. He's got his fast shoes on like me. Well, we started today with a presentation from the Rock Doc, from John Begg, and his key word when it came to the new energy transition was collaboration. We rounded out with the insights of this fellow here, Pete's joining us. He's listened in on all 35 presentations, and his presentation is entitled Skating on Thin Ice, a realistic view of our energy future. Please make him welcome, everyone.
Thank you. So I think this presentation bookends John Begg's presentation this morning quite well, and I've called it Skating on Ever Thinning Ice, and it's called that in recognition of that our home, the Earth, is heating, and it's highly likely that within our lifetimes, for some days during the month of September, there will be no ice on the Arctic Sea over the North Pole. It's getting smaller and smaller. I'd like to talk about global trends in energy supply and take a look at what is happening locally in the oil and gas industry. Additionally, we'll look towards activity in the industry that might give rise to investment opportunities, but of course, no advice is given here. Then I'll look at our energy, social, environmental, and economic future as nations attempt to decarbonize their energy supply against the background of this year's frightening livestock and crop destroying Northern Hemisphere fires, floods, heat waves that foretell more unpredictable anthropogenic climate change. So I'm following on from the last sort of two or three years of good oils, looking at a portfolio. Markets continue to believe that printing money in the form of mounting levels of debt, especially sovereign debt, can continue forever, effectively dragging forward the extraction of finite, non-renewable resources to feed a human hive intelligence on Earth. So the NASDAQ remains overvalued. There's a lot of hopium there. It's really momentum trading, big technology stocks and so forth. Growth has been in the doldrums, really. The value stocks have been in the doldrums for the last 3 years or so. Here locally, we've seen a lot of corporate actions. We've spoken about these today and yesterday with Mineral Resources and Norwest Energy, Hancock on Warrego, Strike on TPD. And in the alternative energy spaces, the renewable energy, Albemarle on Liontown, IGO, of course, bought into Greenbushes, and they basically got their money back in 18 months. It's been a fantastic investment for them, even as the lithium prices weaken. I mean, I've got a portfolio of what I've said in the last couple of years, and haven't changed, is that the portfolio structure should be weighted towards producers and well-funded developers, and there's a list there of those that I'd put in that category. And I think that the markets for energies and base metals remain quite favourable, especially the lithium. So it's important to note, however, that there is a risk that petroleum assets could become stranded over time, not necessarily in the short term. However, shouting just stop oil is a naive and at best ignorant way to proceed. We're currently consuming about 102 million barrels of oil a day, so there's going to be an oil market for decades to come, and methane will be a transition fuel. However, hydrogen is not a fuel. The round trip energy on hydrogen is about 25%. So if you've got 100 units of perfectly good energy and you want to convert that into hydrogen and then use that hydrogen later to produce something, you're going to get 25%. You might as well have used the 100 units of energy you had in the first place. And it's a very powerful, of course, reducing agent. So where are we at the moment? This is a pretty well up to date, sort of a couple of days out of date, those charts. I estimate that the liquefied natural gas energy needs a price of about $8.50 US a gigajoule to encourage new supply, while new supply of oil probably needs $65 a barrel going forward to sustain production. Of course, they can be profitable at areas below that, but they're going to need that sort of price to encourage new production onto the market. The LNG pricing is back to pre-COVID levels at around $13.50 to $14 US a gigajoule currently, while Brent is up about 10 or 20% on the pre-COVID levels. It's currently $90 a barrel US at the Brent. And that's really assisted by OPEC and Russia in the short term, who are restricting supply. And in the short term, we've still got issues around strikes in the Pilbara. We've had Woodside and now Chevron, and that's having putting a bit of nervousness into the market in Europe. So we're living in interesting times. We've got Putin's war still, we've got peak inflation, possibly peak inflation. We've got interest rates that are more normal than the very low interest rates we've had for the last decade or so. We're in an energy transition. We've got lingering COVID. We're coming into another northern winter. Who knows what new variants will pop up. We've had a long period of climate warming with floods, droughts, fires, looming food shortages this year because of the war and because of these weather events. And of course, all of these things are driven by overpopulation pressures, which drive everything. The US Energy Information Agency predicts that there will be a shortfall of oil supply for the remainder of this year, probably as OPEC tightens the spigots there, and that the market would be in slight surplus as economies begin to slow through 2024. I'm not so sure. Maybe markets will remain pretty tight through 24. There's an interesting lineup of non-OPEC producers that are intending to increase supply in 25. You'll see them listed on the bottom there. And of course, in 2025, we see Woodside, Senegal project will be kicking in another 100,000 barrels of oil a day when that kicks up. So if we look at the sort of primary energy sources, supply of wind, solar has really only begun to ramp up in the last decade. It was pretty small 20 years ago, and it's really ramping up. And most of the money in the energy area now is actually going into those areas. So far, the intermittent energy sources have been able to slot into a much larger global energy system. However, batteries and other power firming technologies will be a major focus over the next 20 years and beyond, as weather-dependent generation sources become more prominent. All new energy sources have so far been additive, and other than whale oil, none has ever shown a decline in consumption, though coal is probably now forming a plateau. Still, about 84% of primary energy comes from fossil fuels in 2022, and that's down from 86% in 2000, so it hasn't really changed very much. Presently, there's a backlog of new intermittent power generation capacity waiting to get onto grids in Australia and elsewhere, but the distribution networks are not in place, and many grids already have negative power, the so-called duck curve, in the middle of the day or when the wind is blowing, and you know, it costs you money to get your electricity on to the grid. However, having said that, in China, they're still going ahead with a lot of extra coal. There's 37 gigawatts of new power under construction. That's like 10 times the Swiss, 10 times Western Australia's power grid. And there's about another 100 gigawatts of power, coal-fired power in the works there. So despite the fact that China's sort of leading the world in the manufacture of renewable energy machines and turbines and photovoltaic cells, they're still burning a lot of coal and planning to burn a lot more. So how's this transition going on that basis? And where will the materials come from to build all these new whirligigs and renewable energy machines? The IMF's World Economic Outlook reckons that fossil fuels will supply 66% of primary energy requirements, while renewable energies will be 12% by 2050. So there's 30 years, we're still going to be using a lot of fossil fuels. And of course, overall, the demand for fossil fuels continues to rise. If we look at the primary energy there, we've got this impact equals population times affluence times technology. Population expansion is the primary driver of GDP and energy consumption, and you know, basically emissions and that follow. So I think we're going to see that you know, these carbon emissions and consumption are all driven by population. And I think it's worthwhile remembering that a barrel of oil provides energy equivalent to about 10,000 hours of labor. That allows us to do things we could never dream of doing with only human labor or, you know, animals, farm labor and so forth. So the subsidies that fossil fuels might get are a rounding error compared to the subsidies that oil gives to the current society. What we've got at the moment is underlying issue to sustainability is humanity is deeply in overshoot from what the Earth can sustainably provide. We currently consume more than the planet can sustainably deliver. Earth overshoot day this year was the 2nd of August. So like magic, we create debt, and that debt enables us to pull forward the extraction of more finite non-renewable resources and bring them into the current day. So that's an issue going forward. And when we look at the population and as it grows, the demography and demographics is also working against sustainability. Global human population has quadrupled in 100 years to just over 8.1 billion. And the last 1 billion of us arrived in 11 years. So we're really sort of killing the goose that laid the golden egg. Fossil fuels have been an amazing high density source of energy that supported population expansion from less than 1 billion in 1800 to 2 billion in 1921, and now, as I said, just over 8 billion. Prior to 1850, most energy was supplied by human labour, farm animals and so forth, along with the odd bit of charcoal or the odd water wheel. So really, in the change that's going to happen, either we'll leave oil or oil will leave us, but either way, life on Earth is not going to be the same as it was when we had all these fossil fuels. So we're looking at a situation where we've got these four horsemen of the apocalypse, not the typical conquest, war, famine and death, but we've got this financial breaking where we're spending more money than the underlying value of the assets. We've got the geopolitical war, hunger, mass migration. We've got this complex human society, a globalized society, which we saw how that frayed during the pandemic. And we've got cracks in the social contract where you know, sort of things break down when all these other aspects of the of our community break down. Now, what won't work is renewables as a path to growth with less emissions. The whole Green New Deal is a fantasy with, you know, wind turbines going forward. 1 million scientists jumping up and down and writing reports saying how urgent the situation in all these COP conferences, that hasn't worked either. Technology that results in less emissions and less scale is also not going to work, because we get better technology. Jervin's paradox just shows that the more efficient the technology is, the more we use it, and the more we consume. So how quickly can we transition away from fossil fuels? Well, in 1974, when Australia's population was less than 13 million, Gough Whitlam said that he thought that we would never need more than 15 million. Our first intergenerational report in 2002, when Australia's population was 19.6, said that Australia's population would reach 25.3 million in 2042. And that's a number we reached last year, 20 years ahead of schedule. So every additional 100,000 people in Australia requires an additional 400 doctors, 130 additional nurses, 284 additional hospital beds, 200 additional school teachers, 40,000 new houses, and so the list goes on. So the population expansion is a problem masquerading as a solution. Nat Hagens sees four scenarios. This is my final slide, going forward. The top two are the growth scenarios. We've got the green growth, which is effectively Blade Runner meets Hobbit Town, which is the green New Deal, where we continue business as usual, but with wind turbines. What we're doing is the Mordor on the top right, which is burning and heating the earth that supports all life until it can no longer support a modern civilization. And on the bottom, we've got the degrowth scenarios. On the right is the sort of Mad Max, the sort of Soylent Green, you know, post oil apocalypse scenario. And on the left is the Great Simplification, which is what Nate Hagen says we should be doing, but where the size of the human enterprise on Earth must shrink, which should involve a much smaller population living within the biophysical boundaries of our planet, which we're clearly not doing at the moment. It's a hard ask, and just as unlikely as the Green New Deal fantasy, in my opinion. So this is the pretty well a repeat of what I've done in the last couple of years that showed where the opportunities are in the renewable energy space. Also my doubts on hydrogen. It's a long-term opportunities. It might have uses, but you know, hydrogen is not a fuel. And really there are going to be other opportunities, you know, high purity aluminium, niobium, germanium, gallium, all these small elements that are going to be used in the renewable energy space, but are not really major. So, you know, we're looking at batteries, we're looking at the usual sort of battery minerals and elements that go into that. So that's all I've got. It's an interesting, confusing, and somewhat dangerous outlook, I think, for us going through this century. I just can't see how we can survive. Any farmer knows that when you overstock a paddock, the whole herd does badly. And if you keep on doing it, the paddock itself loses the ability to support any life. So, you know, that's the way we're going, that Mordor strategy. And I just can't see how humans have become this sort of energy hungry, metabolic, mindless super organism, a sort of hive mentality. I just can't see how we can work our way out of it. Thanks for coming.